Steelers at Commanders. Steelers win this game 28-27. Very close game here. Back and forth game between two really good coaches, in my opinion, in Mike Tomlin and Dan Quinn. It was fun watching this one play out. Let's look at the Pittsburgh Steelers' top five graded players in this game because they won. Wide receiver George Pickens had a very, I don't even know what to call that game. It was eventful. Eventful is probably the best way that I could describe George Pickens probably every single week. He had the top grader in an 80.5. Edge rusher Alex Highsmith was 77.8. Edge rusher TJ Watt, a 76.2. And then offensive tackle Broderick Jones, 74.0. We then get tight end Darnell Washington at number five to round things out with a 73.8. Quarterback Russell Wilson in this one, a 79.9, justifying that decision by Mike Tomlin to make the quarterback switch there when they still had a winning record. On the other side of things, for Washington, tier defensive lineman Sheldon Day with an 89.9. I just love how Dan Quinn is elevating the guys in that front seven. It really started out as a struggle for them this season, but now you get, all due respect, you're sometimes getting random names up there where it's like, wow, okay, they had a great performance too. I think that Dan Quinn's putting these guys in a really great spot. So Sheldon Day at the top here with an 89.9. Wide receiver Terry McLaurin with an 82.5. Edge rusher Dorrance Armstrong with a 77.2. Safety Quan Martin with a 72.9. Wide receiver Noah Brown a 71.6. Jaden Daniels, your boy, in this one, a 65.8 overall grade. What do we got here, Dalton? What's the stat that told the story?
So I've got actually a handful of them, because what this was about Mike Tomlin and Terrell Austin planning the right way for this offense. Now, not every team has the personnel to do what the Steelers can do and kind of move things around and what they do up front. But hey, here's what you have, Trevor, and what they did with this offense. One, Steelers had the sixth lowest pass blitz rate in the NFL coming into this week at 26.5%. They blitz Daniels over 58% of the time on his pass plays, all right? Normally, the Steelers, okay, they don't blitz a whole lot.
They don't have to.
They don't have to, right?
Because right?
They can just send four. They can just send four all of the time,
yep.
Right? And okay, so coming into this game, they ran a five-man front about 27, 28% of the time, okay? In this game, right around half the time, all right? And change up the coverages. Normally, cover one. All right, the Steelers, they run a little bit of man coverage, but not over the top like some teams do. Normally, 23% of the time. In this game, 56% of the time. And press coverage on 86% of Washington's snaps. So here's how I'm going to break this down for you. It actually starts in the run game, okay? This five-man front on early downs caused a lot of problems for this run game, because the idea was it was just about not letting Daniels keep it and get outside and make the explosive plays, right? Fine. We will let, if Austin Ekeler and Jeremy McNichols beat us between the tackles, cool. So they lined up in a five-man front, and what you saw was TJ Watt and Alex Highsmith lining up way wider than usual, like serious wide nine stand-up stuff, okay? Keep contained. If you don't let this team run outside, and usually teams, even if they sit outside on the edge, they'll get beat in that gap just inside the edge player, because most teams are in a four-man front, right? They haven't thought of, oh, let's get in a five against Washington and take away that C-gap too, right? So you've got, they're playing extra wide, they're keeping contained. And the other thing they were doing with these edge guys was, instead of sitting and making Daniels just wait out his read, and, you know, because you know how it is with the read option. If he sits, hand it off. If he crashes, keep it, right?
Right, right.
They were crashing, but they were crashing in a direct line at Daniels, not down the line of scrimmage, right, if that makes sense. So TJ Watt, instead of maybe if he wanted to go and get Austin Ekeler, he wasn't coming straight down the line. He was running right at Daniels' outside shoulder, so there was no chance at all that Daniels could keep it. So that's the first thing in the run game is, okay, we're just not going to let him. We're not going to let him do it. And then the Steelers in the passing game, one, they blitzed a lot, so Daniels had to get rid of the ball quick so he couldn't scramble at all.
Mm-hmm.
And the press coverage on the outside, they liked their matchups, okay? They felt like, okay, Terry McLaurin's the only guy that can beat us man-to-man, right?
And he had a good game.
And he had a good game.
Steelers still won.
But the rest of them, not so much. This is the part where earlier in the year I was curious if Washington would actually trade for another receiver, or they were in on the Brandon Ayuk talks,
because
you have one primetime guy outside. But this was a game where the Steelers decided, press up, cover one, we're blitzing, we're going to make him get rid of the ball, and we're going to make the wide receivers win quickly. Everything got sped up on Jaden Daniels, just a little bit, just enough. It's not like he didn't keep his cool. They still scored 27 points. It's not like they're not a top five offense still, but I love the Steelers breaking all of their own tendencies, really, in this game plan, and just finding a way specifically to scratch out enough against this team, even though they still gave up 27 and Washington still got an elite offense. They're still going to compete in the NFC East. Mike Tomlin and Terrell Austin, I thought, put together a master game plan front and back.
I love it. I love you pointing out all that stuff, and it makes a ton of sense when you break it down like that, especially because my stat that told the story was the Commanders' run game without Brian Robinson Jr. You know, he's out in this game, and so you mentioned it's Austin Eckler, it's Jeremy McNichols, but it's also supposed to be Jaden Daniels, right? You're supposed to be okay in this game against the Steelers specifically. And you mentioned, like, they were okay with letting the running backs have a little bit of an advantage between the trenches.
If Austin Eckler beats you between the tackles,
right,
you didn't play well enough.
Yes, right. So in this game, 1.7 yards after contact, lowest of the season for Washington. 2.7 yards per carry overall, lowest of the season for Washington. 59 rushing yards, which was the second single game, the second lowest single game output for them this year. And then Jaden Daniels, here we go. 5 rushing yards in this game, 49.1 rushing grade, both of those lowest on the season. So I did not do that intentionally. I didn't think that my stat was going to mirror perfectly with yours, but that is exactly what happened. Is they were very comfortable saying, okay, we have a quarterback who can do a lot of different things. And when you have a quarterback who can do a lot of different things, when you're a defensive coordinator, you often have to pick and choose. You can't say, okay, well, we're going to try to defend everything that he does here. It just doesn't work like that. It's like a goalkeeper in a penalty kick, right? You kind of just have to guess. You have to commit one way or the other, and you have to hope that sort of plays in your game plan, and maybe they're not ready for it. Maybe you catch him by surprise, whatever. So we played Jaden Daniels, something that we talked about here on the show. What makes him so dangerous? It is the fact that he is willing to be a passer on the run more so than he ever had been in college, which he was a Heisman Trophy winner when he was a between the tackles kind of pocket passer. And yet now you're throwing in this year him being very comfortable keeping his eyes downfield as a passer when he escapes, especially when you get RPO type of stuff or play action type of stuff, which already forces the defense to be a little bit hesitant. So the Steelers very clearly were like, all right, nope, that's not how you're going to beat us. If you can beat us in the middle, if you can beat us more traditionally, fine, go beat us that way. You're not going to beat us in the most dynamic way. And obviously, this is a one-point game, so it was really close anyways. But to me, their inability to run the football, especially without Brian Robinson Jr., was a big deal in this game.
Yeah.
My most impressive, again, Steelers defensive line, it's kind of echoing a little bit of what you said. Newcomer Preston Smith played well in this game, had 2 tackles for loss, had a sack. Cam Hayward, defensive player of the year candidate, 2 tackles for loss, 2 sacks. TJ Watt, a little bit more quiet of a night on the common stat sheet, but two quarterback hits in this one. And you mentioned sort of the role that he played trying to contain Jaden Daniels. So that's a very impressive one for me. And then the most disappointing, just real quick, I'll say it. Unfortunately, it's kind of like the Tyrone Tracy thing. Unfortunately, we got to point on another rookie, a guy that we love here on the show, Johnny Newton. Jumps on the offsides when it was like, all right, you just hear the broadcast. They just say it so many times. They're just like, all right, don't jump. All right, they're going to see if they get the jump. I don't even know if they're going to call this play. And then Johnny Newton jumps at the end, gives him the first down, and the Steelers were able to run out the clock there. But those are my most impressive and most disappointing. What about you?
Real quick, and you mentioned the Steelers defensive line as well. So it might seem like, oh, TJ Watt, he only graded a 76. Usually he's in the 90s, he's the best player on the field and all of that. But I think along with all of the talent and the execution on that Steelers defensive line is a game plan like that, especially one that keeps Watt and Highsmith out of a lot of plays, the way they were playing it, especially in the run game. Those guys inside have played together for so long, and I know Keanu Benton's a young one, but there's so many veteran guys that what gets forgotten in there is not just the talent, but the trust they have in each other to go, okay, TJ has to back off this week a little bit. He can't just come in with the right hook and punching out footballs and doing all the crazy stuff on the ball. If he crashes down and they don't play disciplined football, well, they're going to lose this game, and Jaden's going to take off on him. So I think not only the talent, but the execution and the trust level on that defensive line is so massive when you have – because not every team can do – they can't do what the Steelers did. There's teams that wouldn't be capable of switching the game plan like that and being able to be humble enough to go, okay, the rest of my guys are going to make these plays inside. So I thought just, again, a masterful game plan. And you mentioned their defensive line, they could beat anybody with it. Most impressive, I'll go on the offensive side, George Pickens, like you mentioned. It was eventful. The touchdown catch, reaching up and behind him to catch that was incredible. He had an in route where he broke, 2 or 3 tackles on that play for a big play. Deep catch down the sideline that set up a touchdown in the fourth quarter.
What was the jumping stiff arm one? Is that the one where he was going to the sideline where he caught it and there was just, it was like a he literally like jumped into the stiff arm as if it was like a Street Fighter move?
I mean, he's just there. But we've said it, I think, in a couple of weeks now. There's no one who's benefited more from the switch to 100%. Russell Wilson. George Pickens is a vertical receiver, and what they were adding with Wilson.
That's why Mike Williams is a great addition for them, right? It's the same type of receiver.
Right, because the Jets were throwing it 5 yards every play, and Wilson wants to throw the ball down. I think his average depth of target was like 12-something in this game, which is deep. If you're throwing it consistently that deep downfield, we're talking about, okay, we're hitting home runs in this offense. And that's the one thing they weren't doing with Fields. Again, Justin Fields wasn't playing bad, but he wasn't throwing the ball accurately deep down the field like this. And George Pickens has been the biggest beneficiary. And on the other side, with the most disappointing, you saw the exact reason, and he didn't play yesterday because he's still recovering, I believe, from a hamstring, why Washington traded for Marshawn Lattimore. If they have Marshawn Lattimore, they might win that game yesterday, because you have all three of their primary corners, Mike Sainristil still, Benjamin St. Juice, Noah Igbinoghene, all graded under 60 in coverage. They're the lowest graded cornerback room in the league right now. Marshawn Lattimore is a perfect fit for their team, and they're going to get a lot better with him in there on the outside. And you saw it in this game exactly how they can lose games to receivers on the outside. And if he's not back this week, I believe they're playing Thursday. They're playing Thursday against Philly. If he's not back for this game against A.J. Brown and Devontae Smith, that's going to be issue number one for Washington on Thursday.
Thanks for watching, everybody. Make sure you like and subscribe the video. And if you don't have a PFF Plus subscription, you can get one to see all the premium stats that we talked about here on the show, plus the expert betting and fantasy advice over at subscribe.pff.com. The description is also right below. So if you are not a PFF Plus subscriber, you can come on today.